I'm really lucky to have grown up in a house that didn't look at me as a person who's inherently disordered. They looked at me as a person who's inherently designed. And maybe these things that can cause trouble and that are hard actually can be used for good.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
Sally and Nathan, welcome to Focus.
Hey, thanks, man.
Thanks so much.
Okay, so let's start with the basic question. This is the basic question. When that little kid of yours is in the grocery checkout aisle whining for that candy bar, and you're so embarrassed, that's usually when the parent first realizes, uh-oh, this is not a good day, right? When your kid is just losing it. Mm-hmm. Most children have that, but some kids struggle in that area a lot longer and a lot more severely. Is that fair, Sally?
Yeah, I had already had two children and was pretty convinced I was a great parent. And then I had Nathan, and Nathan's, from the moment he came home, he was different than the other two. He didn't comfort. He had a hard time settling down. And I remember even when he was 18 months old, he would just go ballistic when I would tie the cute little red tennis shoes onto his feet, and I couldn't figure it out. What was wrong with the tennis
shoes?
Something
was wrong, huh?
Yeah.
You know, Nathan's right next to you right now.
Right.
Okay, I just wanted to remind you.
Well,
no,
secrets.
But I love it. We're going to get your part of the story in
Absolutely.
A minute, Nathan. Yeah. But yeah, that's an observant parent, and I can relate to that, some of the behavior I was seeing in one of my sons, and it you know, just caught my attention. He hated to be shampooed, his hair. And anything gel or shampoo kind of substance, it would just set him off. And I didn't, it took me about 3 years to figure that out.
Oh,
because I didn't know.
Smart. It took me about 15.
Well, it doesn't mean I, you know, cured it. But,
I mean, I noticed in retrospect, I learned a lot when I look back and think, oh, that's what that meant.
Well, and that was some of what's happening. And really, it's a good tip for the observant parent. Mm-hmm. You can begin to notice some things that aren't, I hate to use that word even, normal, but they're just not typical.
Yeah.
Let's use that word.
Absolutely.
Nathan, you were the kid. So, I mean, I'm sure those early memories you don't have from about three and earlier. But once you're hitting memory time, 3, 4, 5 years old, do you remember having those fits and thinking, why am I doing this? Or did it not strike you as odd?
It felt like very normal behavior in my mind, but I can remember looking back and seeing myself in the context of other kids in classes in Sunday school, and I would constantly feel like, why am I getting in trouble? Why do I feel the need? I always felt the need to talk back, to talk, to ask questions, to move, to wiggle, to play with my friends. And these didn't feel like bad things, but I found myself consistently getting in trouble. And so I began to notice a stark difference between me and the so-called good kids.
What did that do for your self-esteem and self-worth? Did you feel less than them, or were you just puzzled? I would think it would begin to wear on you that I'm not like them. And
absolutely.
You would feel bad.
Yeah, it creates it starts to create a kind of a division between there's you and then there's the rest of the normal world. And, you know, it's quote unquote, but from a very early age, when you start recognizing these things, it can make you feel very alone. Being different can make you feel ostracized and very isolated.
There was a time, you know, I'm a very involved parent. I love my kids. I affirm them. And we had been on a plane trip, and we were moving. We moved a lot for different ministry options. And we had gone from California, stopped in Albuquerque to see my parents for about 3 or 4 hours, went all the way to Dallas. At this point, it had been a 17-hour trip.
And how many kids do you have, and what number is Nathan?
Nathan is 3. I have 4 now. I mean, eventually I had another one that Nathan prayed for. But I had 3 children, and so it was a constant me taking the Nathan time, jiggling him, and Clay taking him, and then trying to feed him, trying to give him toys, trying to... And by the time 17 hours had passed, and Clay, my husband, said, let's go to this restaurant. I thought, surely food will help. But we got into the restaurant, and Nathan, the way that he expressed himself by saying, this is too much, you know, was to lay on the floor and kick and scream and throw a chicken bone at me. I had hit my limit. I just thought, if I just keep walking with the Lord, if I just keep trying hard, I will reach his heart. But at this point, I remembered thinking, I don't know if I'm going to make it, and I don't know what to do, but I do need a break. And so I left him The other two kids are sitting up straight trying to be really good.
Right.
And Clay
and him on the floor?
I left him on the floor. I did. And I walked over to this little counter that had all these cakes, and I pretended that I didn't know him. I was just trying to get my breath. And this man said to me, "That boy needs a strong hand." And I said, "He certainly does." You know, I was just
now.
At that
Clay
point,
wasn't there. Your husband?
He was over in the corner trying to pick Nathan up
off
the floor.
So you left Clay out there by himself.
Yeah, I'd never done that before, but I thought I think I might burst a gasket.
No, that's true, and that's important. There is so much to unpack in that moment that relates to every one of us.
Yeah,
I'm sure every listener who has a child or who has raised a child has gone through something similar. Mm-hmm. And just that in and of itself is not outside of the bounds of normal. Every kid is going to have a crash. But what you said is really interesting. I want to get back to it. Mm-hmm. That Nathan was trying to communicate something to you.
Right.
When he was feeling overwhelmed, he would throw a fit.
Right.
So he's trying to say something to you, which is, get me out of here. Speak to the people who are saying, no, that what that kid needs is that strong hand, that discipline. He needs a whooping. He needs, I mean, maybe sometimes, maybe, but it's going to be rare when it's defiant. But in that case, he's trying to say to you, help me.
Yeah, and I learned that over a period of time. As I was writing the book with Nathan, I realized that I was him when I was a little girl, and I had been taught to suppress, and I had been taught to be good, and I always felt a little bit guilty that I was too much for people. So when I had these issues with Nathan, I began to pray, God, help me to see what's inside his heart, what's going on. And it was a very long process of learning, but I realized that there was not going to be a magic bullet, no magic formula that was going to help him. I even was praying about it one day, and I feel like the Lord said, this is going to be a long-distance run. Let me carry him, and you just live by faith and do what you can. But you need to love him for who he is, not for what he's not.
Yeah.
So.
And that's really important for parents to hear, because I think all that self-incrimination begins.
Yes.
You know, what have I done wrong? Did I drop him or her when he was really small? Did I not change?
I'm sorry.
Nathan, this is actually an intervention for your mom.
The big reveal just happened.
Drop him on his head. No, but the... you know, that's where we go. It's probably a good place to start, but we don't want parents to linger there long, because there's so much at risk and at work that the Lord is doing things. Nathan, again, I'm coming back to you because this is how you are wired. So I'd like you to describe what that diagnosis was and what it felt like as you began to articulate and understand a little bit more about your defiance, your tactile issues, all those things. Just describe it for us.
Yeah, absolutely. I, from the time I was very little, I can look back, like I said, and realize, oh, I do things differently than other people. Some of them were behavioral. I get in trouble. Some of them were the inability to test well. I could not focus on things. I could not read for longer than 15 minutes. Other times, there's times in high school when I would take maybe 10 to 15 showers a day and wash my hands until they bled. So it became very apparent that this is not typical behavior. That's not what everyone else does. And again, that can make you feel very alone. So it was at that point, probably early high school, I think, 14 or 15 years old, we decided to go and let's see what this is. And luckily, I've been loved and supported through my life up until then. I was not disciplined for being different. And as mom said, these weren't coming from an antagonistic point of view. I wasn't trying to be bad, but these are just parts of who I was and how I thought and how my mind is wired. But when we finally did get diagnosed, all these different things, it was OCD, ADHD, ADD, ODD, dyslexia.
Now, ODD, most people won't know ODD, but describe that.
Yeah, it's
it's most teenagers, I think, are...
I think
every teenager has ODD.
I have a normal boy or something.
Yeah, what is ODD?
It stands for Oppositional Defiance Disorder. And I think, I don't know if that's a disorder. I think it's a strength to be trained, and luckily I think people want to call it disorder because they want kids to shut up and not bother them and talk back.
Boy, that is a great point.
But I was diagnosed because I always want to talk back. I always want to give my opinion, and that's part of who I am. It's not necessarily something to squelch or get rid of, but it's something to train and be used for good. But yeah, so I had all this list of.
So go back to the beginning though.
Yeah.
You went fast. So OCD is
obsessive compulsive disorder, and it's it has such a stigma in TV shows and movies. It's really hard to describe, but essentially it's just the inability to control your thoughts. Your thoughts run your mind as opposed to vice versa.
Repetitive thoughts.
Yeah, repetitive thoughts, unwanted thoughts. So it's it can be very distressing, especially for a young kid to a teenager. And even now it's something I deal with. And then ODD is oppositional defiance disorder. ADHD, I think we're pretty familiar with this one, is even to this day, I make myself, I have a hard time reading more than 15 minutes at a time. My counselor said it's like a channel's changing constantly in your head. So it's just less control of your mind again. And then I have dyslexia, and then just a host of learning disabilities, just basic things I can't grasp. But through all of these, it's interesting, they always have a disorder on the end of them.
Yeah.
And I'm really lucky to have grown up in a house that didn't look at me as a person who's inherently disordered. They looked at me as a person who's inherently designed. And maybe these things that can cause trouble and that are hard actually can be used for good if they're trained and dealt with and not seen as just bad.
Right. And it's important for us to understand how we can get that parental perspective to say, okay, this child is unique. Mm-hmm. They think differently. They have different challenges. How did you do that as a parent once you received the diagnosis with Nathan? Did you change some things?
No, the thing is, we had four children at home, and we needed him to learn how to gently, little by little, begin to submit to the family culture. We had a real verbal environment, so Nathan loves to talk. So we would ask questions at the dinner table and give him things to think about. He loved stories. I would try to find one or two things that he was good at. And he fell in love with Superman at 7 years old. And so I would just sit him next to me and read hero tales and say, you're going to be a hero someday. And you have a story in God's kingdom to tell. And I wonder what you're going to do. You're going to accomplish something great because you're Nathan. So I feel like our whole parenting philosophy, people criticize us all the time, said our children were going to go to jail because we were, so nurturing of them. I was kind of raising my children during the years when we were highly criticized for discipling them according to their heart needs, training little by little. And really, all of our kids are so different. And yet we would really appeal to them according to the things that they individually loved, would give them steps forward. And I never expected Nathan to do exactly what the other kids did, but I did expect him to move forward little by little in the area of character and in honoring us.
Let me come back to that, because family and extended family and friends, and I would say, our church friends can be very brutal in that kind of moment, mm-hmm. and give us advice that is coming in, I think, somewhat out of their own frustration. If I was parenting that kid, I would do a much better right. job. And all you need to know, Sally, is you do this, this, and this,
right.
and Nathan would be whipped into shape. You must be a pathetic mom.
Right.
I mean, that's what they say without saying
and
it.
And if you only did this more or this more.
Right.
And I think that my heart goes out to people who are listening to this story today, because I think that what happens is when you live in your own home with the differences, and you know they're different.
Right.
At least most of the time. Sometimes people haven't attended to their children enough and they're acting out because they just need more love. But you know they're different, and yet people don't want you to have a different child. And so I felt the hardest thing for me was no one understood. No one answered my questions. I didn't feel like I had a lot of help, mm-hmm. because when I would communicate this to friends or people, they thought they were being nice by saying, oh no, he's great. And I would think, I know he's great, but he has these issues and I wish somebody could help me understand.
Right, and that's helpful to know what they are and what to do to
right.
kind of mute, to the degree you could mute it, those attributes that, needed to be managed. Nathan, let me ask you this. The being that young man, when were you cognizant again of that difference, and how did that play into your emotional well-being and your spiritual well-being? That you were different, you had these labels at least running through your mind, of ODD and ADHD, and now I know where I'm deficient.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
But But how did that make you feel as a 15, 16, 17-year-old? And how did you cope with that? What did you do to, did you want to help your mom and dad, or did you want to frustrate them, or the answer is yes to both questions?
Sure, absolutely.
But what was that like being that young man, and yeah. how did you begin? I mean, you are an articulate guy. How old are you now?
I'm 28.
So you have had some years, adult years, of managing this and better understanding it. But you seem to be in a great place today. So what? Take us over the last 10 years or so. How did it go?
Yeah, it's been, I mean, 10 years is quite a journey. Do we have a few hours? But no, it's going back to being 15, 16, dealing with these issues. That's already a hard time, even if you're not dealing with all these labels and disorders. So it created me a lot of angst, and I guess I love people. I'm connecting to people, so it created a lot of division too, because I didn't feel like other people. I didn't fit in the places I really desired to and wanted to. But I think what I was lucky enough to have was a family and a home system in which I wasn't forced into a box. Because I think the world oftentimes, especially that age in the public school system, wants to fit you into a box of you learn like this, you act like this. And I was lucky that no matter what other system I was trying to fit into, I could always come home and I would find a place in which I wasn't asked to be anybody but myself. And like she just talked about, that doesn't mean I can just do whatever I want. It means that I had a unique puzzle piece that was meant to fit within the context of my family, of my church, and I had to figure out how this unique puzzle piece fits with everyone else and whatever else was a unique puzzle piece. And I will say this, we talk a lot about the different kids. I really believe every kid is different in some way or another. Mm-hmm. My differences are louder and more noticeable and easier to quantify, I think. But I think every kid is different in some way or another. And I think that's an okay thing. It can be scary because we like, as humans, to quantify and put in boxes and control things. But yeah, I believe that everyone's different in some way or another.
Yeah, I'm thinking of that parent listening right now who has that different child. Mm-hmm. And it is tangible. Hmm. As the son who was that different child, what advice would you give to that mom or dad who now is beginning to notice my 7-year-old, my 8-year-old is saying things or acting in a way that seems destructive? Hmm. What would you say to mom and dad as that child, now grown up, a young man? What would you say to mom and dad?
There's a lot I would want to say, and that's why I wrote the book with mom. But I would say, first, understand that when God creates people, he is not a cookie-cutter God. He creates nature and this entire universe in a very unique way. So don't expect your child to fit into a box of what culture expects them to be, what school expects them to be, what church expects them to be, or their friends or family, that God has made this child uniquely. And he's given this child to you to deal with this unique story, and that it's okay if they don't fit the mold of what entire society says they should. And these things that are different about them can ultimately be the things that will be great about them, that will enable them to tell a great story with their lives. And so if you encourage these different things and train them and hone them, that can be the very thing that will ultimately let this child who's having so much trouble live a really successful and healthy life.
What discipline worked for you, Nathan? Mm-hmm. I mean, with the elements that you had, OCD and ODD and what were the approaches that your mom and dad used that seemed to resonate with you, and what didn't?
Yeah. I would say that the base of it is that they never saw as a cookie-cutter thing, that they would always do the same thing. They took every situation as an individual situation and sought God in it and talked to me. So it was never just if you do this, it's always going to be this. Let's talk about this entire situation, the context. And then they always, whenever they did discipline in any way, it was always very clearly understood. It was never in reaction. It wasn't a smack across the face. It was let's talk about this because you need to understand what's going on and why this is not acceptable, why this is acceptable, or how to use this better, how we can do this better next time.
And we used a lot of stories. I told Nathan he was the wild stallion, and I said that the wild stallion didn't win the race until he learned to accept the reins. Mm-hmm. And I said, and we're here to help you learn how to accept the boundaries of our discipline so that you can win the race.
I think like boundaries is a really good thing to.
We would little by little set boundaries, and And we knew that it might take him longer to learn a situation. But poor old him, he would always be taken away from when he did a situation. Let's talk about this or what was going on, as well as the fact that he needed grace a lot of times.
Mm-hmm. Sally, I'm mindful of that parent whose 28-year-old has not kind of found their way yet. That's going to happen too.
Right.
Maybe 38.
Right.
Could be 48. I don't know. But it's, you know, it's just is not happening. Mm-hmm. What hope do they have? And what can they do?
You know, I think each of us has a different puzzle, and we're just asked to be, I think our spiritual service of worship is really to trust God with your puzzle, regardless of what it is.
Yeah.
And I feel like I have four adult kids, and it's just as demanding now as it was when they were little, and they're all at different points of maturity. But I do think that I would say don't carry guilt. You know, that your children also need to make choices,
right.
And they might have difficulties forever. There might be a prodigal, but I think that our kids flourish better if we decide to be happy parents. I know that may seem funny, but I realize that if every time I saw my child, I was communicating guilt or commands or expectations, that there wouldn't be any freedom there.
Or joy.
And we had to learn, I had to learn over a period of time to put my children in the file drawer of heaven, close the drawer and say, I don't know what's happening, but God is good. And I'm going to love my child. And I'm going to trust God that in his time, because I don't think any parent doesn't have a lot of disappointments or difficulties.
Yeah.
But I realized that I needed to be in control of me, not allow my children's circumstances to determine how I felt.
Thank you for that transparency. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's hard to write a book like this, a beautiful book.
Well, it was his idea.
Different. And and then to talk about it publicly, I mean, those are things that can be a little uncomfortable, but I'm so proud of your courage.
Well, thank you.
And people will be helped. And you know, Nathan, the truth of it is a lot of parents are going to be helped. And because of that, a lot of young people will be helped, especially in their relationship with Christ.
That's our hope.
And that is a beautiful thing to do. Sally and Nathan, the one thing we didn't get to, but people need to get the book. You use that acronym LAUNCH to remind yourselves how to deal with parent-child relationship. We're not going to have time to cover it, but I love elements of it. Get the book, and it's covered in there. Loving him is the L of LAUNCH, affirming him daily, him or her, if you have a daughter. Understanding his limitations, never passing guilt onto them. That's so important. That's where I struggle. I mean, I can go there so quickly as a parent. You know the right thing to do.
Right.
Why not do it? you love
making
that one,
making assumptions
huh?
about their motives.
I heard Nathan chuckle at that.
Visible reaction to that one, yeah.
Changing his heart gradually through training character and inner strength. Wow, that is good. And then finally, the H of LAUNCH, holding expectations loosely and leaving him in the hands of God. Those are wonderful elements, and they're in the book. And I'm looking forward to reading this with Jane. Thank you for being with us.
Thanks so much.
Thanks so much. It's such an honor to be here.
Hey, I'm John Fuller, and thanks for watching. Get more info about Focus over here and more from our guests over there. And be sure to subscribe to our channel as well.